And welcome back again, everybody. Hesitate a little bit because I kind of lost my place. I'm John Williams, and this is In the Pits. It is our Friday and our weekend show. Always a pleasure to have you with us. We are coming to you from the studios of the Williams Broadcasting Group, and I'm John Williams, along with my longtime co-host Scott Tapley, who is the race director for Stafford Motor Speedway, Thompson Speedway Motorsports Park, Thunder Road, Riverhead Raceway, and of course now the American Canadian Tour. Dana Nelson is going to join us at some point, we think.
He's
here. Dana Nelson is here from the Oxford Casino. Good morning, Dana.
Good morning.
Always a pleasure to have you with us. And Mark LaBelle, of course, from the great state of Massachusetts. And good morning to all of you. And a special guest, and I refer to him as a guest, but he is a friend, an associate, and someone who I have been so privileged to get to know over the years. Dr. Dick Bergren joins us once again on In the Pits. And Dick, it's always a pleasure to have you with us, my friend.
Good morning. I enjoy very much talking with you guys.
Well, thank you very much for that. We are New England's premier motorsports race show, everybody, coming your way every week live Friday at 9 o'clock. That's right now. And again on Monday at 6 p.m. online. And we are live streaming at WilliamsBroadcasting.net. It's easy to pick us up on live stream. Simply go to the website at WilliamsBroadcasting.net, click onto the microphone at the bottom of the page, and we'll be there live with you. And don't forget that you can also listen to us on demand virtually everywhere, including iTunes and iHeartRadio, Spotify, Radio.com, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can also go directly to the website at WilliamsBroadcasting.net, click onto the icon that says In the Pits. It'll take you right to the homepage. You can listen to us there and listen to all of our archive shows. And don't forget, we are syndicated every Saturday on New England Superstation, Sports Radio 96.3 and 92.5 FM, The Big Jab, and of course on Sunday on WOXO 92.7 and 100.7 with the Bennett Radio Group. Once again, got a little frog in my throat this morning, Dick, but once again, it's great to have you with us. And something that I think I had mentioned to you earlier, Dick, and I thought I would start by saying, on Monday, as of Monday, In the Pits will begin its 20th consecutive year of broadcasting.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing. I mean, most shows, I don't care what it is, television, radio, podcast, don't last near that long. Congratulations.
Well, I'm very, very grateful, and I'll tell you why. Because because of people like my co-hosts who have been such a special part of the show all during the years that we've been broadcasting, but also people like yourself who we've gotten to know, who have become friends of the show and become participants in the show on a regular basis, and we couldn't be happier. I've got you today, and then next Friday I've got Mario Andretti. Now, that's a great 1-2 punch.
That's amazing. Well, the other thing that you got going for you is you've got a great sport to talk about. There's nothing more exciting or interesting or faster than automobile racing.
And you've got that right for sure. And why don't we kick right into that, Dick? You had a number of things that you brought up that we could potentially talk about today. But I think one of the things that we probably would like to talk a little bit about is that obviously there's been a lot of news about the next gen car, and they seem to have sort of gotten things squared away. And we've talked a lot about that on our show, you know, from the spoiler to the horsepower and that type of thing. And maybe you can just sort of give us a sense of how you're feeling about that car as we get ready. And it's coming sooner than later to get this car basically ready for actual competition.
Well, this is the biggest change that NASCAR has had to their cars since the very beginning of NASCAR. Their first year of racing was 1948, and this is the biggest change by far since 1948. Probably the biggest change between 48 and now was the introduction of the purpose-built chassis. In the beginning, stock car racing used the same stuff that was on the showroom floor. All the body panels were stock, the chassis was stock, and when they finally allowed teams to be able to use 2x4 and other shapes of steel tubing to build the chassis, that was a huge change. And now everything is aftermarket. There is no way that NASCAR can even imply that these cars have anything to do with what you're liable to see in a showroom. It's a spec car. It's all specifically built for racing. There is one single source for the chassis. used to be that every team built their own chassis. Now everybody buys the same chassis. Front clip bolts on, rear clip bolts on, center section probably would survive a crash. The body, no longer steel, carbon composite. The wheels, no longer 15 inches, now 18 inches. No longer steel, they're aluminum. No longer five bolts. It's one nut in the center of the wheel that'll hold it to the car. Transaxle in the back end. Transmission, rear gears, have to buy all those from an aftermarket source. You have one choice. Soon coming, think this is crazy, soon coming, hybrid electric. NASCAR is trying to persuade Dodge to join. The only way Dodge will join is if we have some sort of a hybrid engine, and NASCAR is preparing to move in that direction. Going back to the car, the next-gen car, even the number on the car moved. Better advertising space. The body is smaller. The rear end is independent. No longer the steering system that we've had all these years. It's now going to be rack and pinion. I mean, it's just, I could probably go on for the rest of your show with the changes that are there, most of which are not going to be visible by fans sitting in the grandstands or at home watching it on television. NASCAR's plan is to try and make the cars so alike, one the same as the other, that it will put the race in the hands of the drivers and the crews. The crews don't have much to do with it anymore other than pit stops and race strategy because there's not a lot that they can do with the pieces and parts that they buy. So it really is going to be up to the drivers. And we'll see how all this works. This is a lot like IROC, where the cars really were all identical, and fans just never really took to IROC. I hope that's not the case here. I hope fans see the excitement that these drivers bring to your TV screens or bring to the racetrack as you're sitting in a stadium. I hope that works, but we don't know. I mean, NASCAR is really sticking its neck out from racing in the Coliseum to start its year to racing on dirt to a whole new car that's not anything like what you drive on the street.
Dick, I want to mention, you said the Coliseum, and it's obviously one of the biggest stories coming into the season is this big event that's going to be at the LA Coliseum. I was fortunate enough to be a part of all the Toyota All-Star Showdowns that were at Irwindale for years, and I know you called a bunch of those races. I think there's a kind of a misnomer that there aren't a lot of race fans in Southern California. That place was sold out every year for names that nobody knew about. Talk a little bit about that environment, especially back then, and how many race fans there actually are out there. And that's kind of a false narrative that's been out there that there's really no race fans out there.
Well, California has always been car country. I mean, if you go out to Los Angeles and just sort of stand on the sidewalk or the edge of the freeway and see what people are driving, there's probably more cars that have been customized and hot rodded there than any place else in the country. And that's in part because the weather in California produces that sort of ability. You can have a nice car there, and you can drive it all year long. Try that in New England. Try driving your nice car in the dead of winter when they've got sand and salt on the road, and you've got corrosion as a result of your nice car. California is really where hot rodding began. Some of the best drivers we've ever seen in automobile racing have come out of California. I'm with you, Scott. I think this thing in the Coliseum is going to be a big hit. I sure hope so, but I think the odds are in NASCAR's favor on this one.
Hey, Dick, we're approaching a Chili Bowl time, and we're starting
yes,
to see.
Yes, we are.
Actually, it kind of officially started a couple days ago with the Tulsa Shootout. But we're starting to see a whole bunch more drivers from other disciplines getting into these midgets and racing on the dirt. In fact, Kyle Busch won a 600cc Micro Outlaw or Outlaw Micro race, was it Wednesday night? So do you think that more and more of the top-level drivers are going to be getting into these kind of cars and getting into these kind of events in the future?
Well, Chase Elliott's talking about racing when I don't know if he's actually going to show up next when they run this thing. This is, the race itself is a couple of weeks, the big race is a couple of weeks off. But certainly there have been Kyle Larson, two-time winner. He's won the last 2 years in a row. He's a cup racer. But the majority of the people who are racing in the Chili Bowl, which let me back up a little bit and tell for those who don't know what the Chili Bowl is, this is a race that is held indoor in the Tulsa, Oklahoma Expo Stadium. They actually build a quarter-mile dirt track inside it. It's big enough, the building is big enough to hold the majority of transporters inside the building and to have the races as well. 15,000 people are going to see it. It's going to be live on MAV TV. And the stars of today are all there. And we've got some New England people that are participating in it. David Gravel's got a ride for it. Sammy Swindell, a five-time champion of the Chili Bowl, is there with an engine from Tim Bertrand, a local New England guy. So Sammy owns the car. Tim owns the engine. With Sammy's five-time winning background, they could become the Chili Bowl champions. Brady Bacon's running. Of course, Kyle Larson's going to be there. Rico Abreu, a two-time champion, is going to be racing in it. And just about anybody else that's a major player. Tim McCready is going to be running in it. There are, at this point, I counted them, 358 entries. There'll be one winner. You talk about excitement, and I'm going to guarantee you there are going to be at least a dozen midgets upside down before this thing is over. The crashes are dramatic. They flip a lot of cars in the indoor race at the Chili Bowl.
Yeah, I think last year their flip count was, 70 or 80?
Yeah.
Because that is actually a sponsored statistic for both the Tulsa Shootout and the Chili Bowl. Every time somebody goes on their lid, the flip count with a sponsor shows up, showing what the official flip count is.
Yep. Yep. And it's usually pretty safe. I mean, the speeds are not so high that people get hurt. Once in a while, somebody does. Tim McCready got hurt pretty bad there in a flip. So it's serious stuff, but it's fun, and it is the craziest weekend, I think, in short track racing in the country. To get that many cars, that many drivers, that many teams participating, all trying to win this thing, and it's going to be fun for a lot of them.
Dick, it always amazes.
Yeah, we have a.
Go ahead, Dan.
I said we have a subscription to Flow Racing, so we're going to be watching. I mean, it starts Monday night and goes every night, and we're talking a full program every night, of which if it was the middle of summer and you saw this lineup of drivers, you'd go, holy crap, I'm seeing quite a race.
Yeah, it is quite a lineup, and it's a well-run show. I mean, this thing is not filled with a lot of delays. It's filled with a lot of racing.
Dick, it always amazes me that when the Tulsa Shootout comes out and we get up to this race, that you get a lot of interlopers, and they always seem to. You've got the guys that run dirt all year long, all season long. Then you got these guys like Christopher Bell and some of the others that come in and they're competitive. I mean, how do you explain that? How do you just come into a one-off like this and perform the way some of these guys do and make it through that week and all that qualifying?
Well, I think part of it is that you've got so many cars everybody kind of starts with a level playing field in terms of where they're going to start the feature or even if they're going to get there. There are so many participants that the qualifying goes all the way back to the O main. So you got to finish well in the O main to make it to the end. You got to finish well in the N main to make it to the M main, and you could get a guy that just doesn't have a whole lot of experience, maybe with midgets, but has a lot of sprint car experience or dirt late models or even asphalt late models, and could go there and just go like crazy. I mean, it's possible for an outrider to win it, but it's highly unlikely. I mean, if you look at the history of this thing, it's all been people who have a lot of experience in dirt tracks, a lot of racing experience with open wheel cars.
Hey, Dick, I want to go back to, I know that we're going to get back to some New England oriented news coming forth, and we want to talk about that with you as well. But I want to just talk about Formula One for just a moment, if you don't mind.
I am so glad you are wanting to talk about it.
I mean, the Drive to Survive on Netflix, the extraordinary popularity surge that we have seen in Formula One in the last year, and then this championship race and the way in which it culminated. In no particular order, could you comment on some of that?
Yeah. Well, for those who have not seen Drive to Survive on Netflix, I strongly urge you to watch it. What it is probably the closest, most personal look at a racing series, big league racing series, we've ever seen. So you've got some drivers that don't like each other, and there they are with no holds barred. I mean, it's an incredible program. You watch it, and you see, you understand the level of difficulty of winning a Formula One race, never mind a Formula One championship. It's a great show. But it reminds me of Madhouse, which was a series that took place. I can't remember where it played. It might have been one of those small stations or small channels, I should say, that covered some NASCAR stuff. But it focused on Bowman Gray Stadium and the rivalries of Bowman Gray and the fights after the race. And they got comments from the drivers that didn't like other drivers. They had people doing crazy stuff with cars and winning races, and then afterwards running into somebody that gave them a bad time in the race. So we had that. We had essentially Drive to Survive with a short track. It ran for a couple of years and then just never repeated.
And looking at Formula One right now, and again, getting back to the way this season ended with Hamilton and Verstappen and the controversy associated with the last race, but even more so the fact that these were two drivers that were going head-to-head all year long. Yep. And obviously Lewis Hamilton was trying to make history by winning his eighth championship. He's already got the most career wins, and an extraordinary driver who really surged toward the end of the season. You know, what was your thought about just the general entertainment factor and the racing in general at the Formula One level through the end of the season and then finally that final race?
Well, let's just take a look at what happened at the Texas race, the Austin, Texas race. Sold out grandstand, sold out for 2022 in 2021. Yeah. What it says is Formula One has captured the attention of people worldwide. It's really worked. The drama that's there, the excitement that's there was so well explained in Drive to Survive. And now that people understand it, they love it. And it's the same with our local level racing. People that go to Thunder Road Speedway or go to Stafford Speedway or Thompson Speedway on a regular basis, they understand what's going on and they love it. But the people that show up for a one-off, hard to understand. Ours is a difficult sport to figure out. And for many people who come without really doing their homework or knowing what's going on, it's just cars going in circles. Drive to Survive showed us not just cars going in circles. There's a lot of human element to it all. And those who are regular fans of racing in New England or NASCAR fans, they understand that, and they appreciate the sport as a result. You can't just catch on to automobile racing watching a single event. You got to watch a bunch of them to figure out how this thing works.
Yeah, you have to know the personalities for sure. That's what you always did on TV, is you told those stories and you made it, you know, tangible for people to understand. I'll say one thing about that before moving on to my question. It was on the History Channel, that Madhouse show. That thing blows me away that was what was the vehicle for that show, was the History Channel. It's still laughable today that it was on that channel. But we have a big race coming up here in New England with the Spring Sizzler. You have a major hand in the creation of that event. It's the 50th running of it this year. And not having NASCAR there, it's a huge story. Talk a little bit about this event and how you think it's going to play out without NASCAR being there.
Well, as a little bit of background, the original Spring Sizzler on April 16th, 1972, was the result of Bruce Cohen, Lou Boyd, and I being desperately broke and still wanting to race. Lou was racing stock cars, and I was racing stock cars, and Lou needed an engine, and I needed a car. We didn't have any darn money. Bruce needed a truck because we only had one, so we could get both cars to where we had to go. So we decided we would run an auto race and get rich. We worked our brains out all winter long, and when race day came, We had so many people that came to that original Spring Sizzler, and we'd broken ourselves up. So Lou was in charge of the infield and the racetrack, Bruce was in charge of the pits, and I was in charge of the grandstand. And I had a guy with eyeballs about 8 inches wide show up, and he said, "The cops at the front gate want you right now." Whoa. I go to the front gate, and it's the state police, and they say, "You need to lock these gates." Why? "Because you've got too many people in here already. This place is overcrowded. Lock them up." So I had to go stand there and tell the people that were still standing in line for the original Spring Sizzler, "Sorry, we can't accommodate you. The state police have just locked us down." The reason it was such a huge success was because of the format of the race. It was 80 laps long. This was in contrast to a lot of the races that were running it at the time with 200 laps, 300 laps, 500 laps. We liked the short races. That's what we did. We raced where you didn't take a pit stop for anything. Pull off the racetrack and you were done for the night. So 80 laps is what we wanted to have. But we also wanted to have a wide array of people that race fans had heard about but had maybe never seen. So we went to a lot of trouble to go to other racetracks in the fall and in the spring, and we came down to Daytona and met up with people, and we got people that raced dirt ordinarily that never would have been seen at Stafford Springs Speedway. And by the time it got done, we had over 120 cars in the pits. And probably half of them were people that the folks in the grandstand had heard of but never had actually seen. So it was as much a happening as anything else. Well, Stafford Speedway has taken a page out of our playbook, and they're doing a lot of the same stuff. Their race is going to be 100 laps. It's not a NASCAR race, so you bring yourself a modified, and as long as it's safe, you're okay to run. There are no conflicts. There's nothing else of major importance running that day. We have that advantage as well. And it's a huge purse, $130,000. That's the biggest purse in the history of Stafford Racing. And that's a track that's been around since the 1940s. This is by far the biggest purse. It's possible that the guy who wins it or the woman who wins it is going to take home $30,000. We got big names already mentioned as people who are going to participate. They're taking entry blanks. And you go to the Stafford Speedway website, and you can look it up. Maybe your favorite driver has already entered in the Spring Sizzler. But it's going to be a corker. It really is. I'm so looking forward to this. Oh, by the way, qualifying is going to be set by racing. We did that, too, rather than time trials.
Are you have inverts? Are they going to have inverts? Because I've always thought
I don't
that
think
was
they
the
are.
Magic
we
of short
do,
track
I,
racing.
We didn't. No, we didn't do an invert. We did heats, and we drew for position as to where you were going to start the heat. Winner of the first heat started on the pole. Winner of the second heat started on the outside of the front row. And I hope they're going to do it that way. That really worked well for us. It also worked well for Bobby Turner because he won that first heat, and that was probably the thing that brought his name to attention more than anything else he did. All the races he won elsewhere. That Spring Sizzler thing, because here's a guy that built his car. He built it himself. That was his welder that glued it all together. That was his brain that figured out what that car ought to look like and how the chassis should be set up. It was just a great story. It really was. So I hope that they don't do any invert, but that the winner of the first heat will start on the pole, winner of the second heat on the outside pole.
Hey, you know, earlier you mentioned about NASCAR, you know, looking at going to electric or hybrid vehicles. Do you think that's going to remove, you know, the visceral sensation of you know why a lot of us go to races is to you know to feel those cars, the power of those cars going in the corner. You know, will the whoosh of you know 20 gigawatts of power be a sufficient replacement to just regular horsepower?
I don't know. I've got a lot of different views on that. I'm hearing what you're saying with hearing aids in. I'm almost deaf as a result of spending my life around racing car high-performance engines that had no mufflers. And it is a thrill when they drop the green flag at the start of a race and you get this enormous surge of noise amid the excitement of seeing the cars accelerate to get into the first turn. By the same token, Andy Cusack at Beech Ridge had a race class that ran with mufflers And I went up and I watched that on a Thursday night. It was a Thursday night show. I went and I watched it, and I loved it. You know why? You could hear the tires squeal, and you could hear the drivers yelling at each other between the cars. And it just added such an element of excitement. You could hear car 13 yelling at the driver of car 14, "I'm going to get you. Wait till the next time we get a green flag here." This would be under caution, of course. And the announcer up top would pick it up and say, "Watch car 13, car 14. Did you hear that? They're looking to get each other." It was great stuff. So, in some ways, I mean, I'd like to have my hearing back, but I would miss the drama of the start with the noise of the engines. But I like to hear the drivers yelling at each other. That's why the scanners are so popular in NASCAR.
Honestly, most of the races I go to, they have a muffler rule. Now, they're racing mufflers as opposed to street mufflers, yeah. But they're still loud. You know, you still need hearing protection, even though they have mufflers on them.
Well, I think we're going to see a lot from this year with the next-gen car as to what the racing fans are going to accept. I mean, certainly a car that gets crashed, the next-gen car that gets crashed, isn't going to look the way a car with a steel body that crashes looks. And whether fans will accept that or not, I don't know. But if fans accept all of the next-gen, I think I would certainly... If I were NASCAR, I would try to sort of phase it in a little bit before they wind up with these hybrid engines. I don't know enough about electric cars, but I would think that a car that's perfectly silent on a super speedway going at 190 miles an hour would be exciting to watch. And I don't know if you really need to hear the sound of the engine. I don't know.
So conversely, if you want to hear the sound of an engine, we're going to have the resurrection of the big block super modifieds. I know you're
hooray!
Very familiar with them. I spent a lot of time at Lee in the 90s, and my two favorite divisions were the hobby stocks and the super modifieds. How exciting is that for New England race fans?
Well, I sure hope it works out. I mean, we've got big block super modified series that races here in New England. It's called International Super Modified Racing, ISMA. It's just not pulling enough cars. Fans love it, but it's not pulling enough cars. They can't run a race at Thompson with a dozen or 15 or 17 cars. You really need a field of 24 or more at Thompson. This new series has got 8 races scheduled all over New England. I didn't see Thompson on the list. I hope they do get to run there. It is going to run Thompson.
Yeah.
During the fall.
Yeah, I think it's series, I think it's October 8th. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Buy your ticket now, because that's going to be really good. If ISMA manages to get together with the big block guys, and it looks like they're all cooperating with each other, if we get enough cars, big blocks at Thompson Speedway is just that's a race that is as good as you're going to see anywhere. I mean, it's a lot of drama, excitement, and you look at those cars and they are so out of whack in terms of what you would drive on the street. They are real race cars and real fast and are real good. So this new big block series, I think, is going to be strong in New England. I hope so.
Dick, we've kept you for almost a half an hour. Anybody else have any questions that they wanted to ask Dick before I just ask him one last question? Then we'll let him get going. It's been great to have him on the air today for as long as we've had him, and great subject matter as well. Anybody?
Only about 100, but I don't want to keep him for another half hour.
We'll keep that in store. Dick, you know, as we look towards 2022, specifically with NASCAR, we see what has happened with Survive to Drive and how that series has fueled the surge of popularity with Formula One and given it eyes all over the world, really, that perhaps were not on it before that. Is this something that NASCAR needs to really look at doing more of, you know, as we move ahead and look at what it is that attracts people today, whether it's online, social media, whatever it happens to be?
They're all over that. They are all over that. They are also looking at producing a series for television that's like Drive to Survive, and it's my understanding they're talking with NBC about doing it. I hope they can pull that off.
Yep.
I hope it's even half as good as Drive to Survive. But I'd like to see NASCAR go back and play some of those madhouse shows. Those things were just so entertaining. I mean, you have two brothers that race against one other guy that they're mad at, and they would talk about it in madhouse, and they're doing the same thing in Drive to Survive. And, and we've gotten so sanitized in NASCAR. They don't like conflict between the drivers, and I think the conflict between the drivers is key, and we've seen that this year in Formula One.
Well, Dick, thank you so much for joining us. Let me wish you the happiest of New Year's. We're going to be doing some things to celebrate our 20th year. And when that happens, I'm going to bring people. You remember Bill Ryan.
Yes.
And Travis Barrett, who was also a part of my my co-hosting for a number of years. Yep, exactly. We're going to try to get them back in studio so we can do a special show. And when that happens, I'm going to ring you up, my friend, and get you on the show as well. So
I would love to.
Yeah, absolutely. So thank you so much as always, and please take care of yourself. And once again, a safe and happy New Year to you and your family. And we'll talk again very soon.
I look forward to that. Thank you, John.
You betcha. Take care. Bye bye now. That is Dick Bergen joining us, and once again, always a pleasure to have him with us. And his commentary is so valued here on In the Pits. And we've spent the first half hour talking with Dick. We're going to take a little bit of a break and give our sponsors some air time. We'll come back and talk more motorsports. I'm John Williams once again for Scott Tapley and Dana Nelson, and also Mark LaBelle. It is In the Pits, everybody. It's our Friday and our weekend show. Hold on, we're coming right back.
Oxford Casino Hotel is built for the way you play.
The other casinos, there's so many people, and they just don't interact with you like they do here.
It's a whole different world in my book. This is homey.
I like it just the way it is.
Bigger is not always better.
Oxford Casino Hotel, just the way you like it.
Persons under 21 years of age may not enter the gaming area unless licensed as employees. Gambling problem? In Maine, call 211 for help or 1-800-522-4700.
Uncle Andy's Digest. It works. What a way to advertise. Get your business on the rise. Limericks, facts, and quotes, and jokes. And it's all free.
Holy smokes.
The Central Maine is where you be. Uncle Andy's, that's the key. The ads just jump right off the page.
Jimbo's jokes are all the rage.
Entertaining little quirks. Sell your business, get the perks. Uncle Andy's Digest. It works.
Hey everybody, nothing sets your stress levels higher than an emergency at home. If you've experienced a flood or fire at your home or business, rest assured that ServiceMaster Fire and Water Restoration, they're just a phone call away. With 24-hour emergency response, ServiceMaster will get your home or business back to normal quickly using state-of-the-art equipment. Their technicians expertly repair damage from burst pipes, flooded basements, fires, furnace malfunctions, mold, sewage, and bodily trauma. Be confident knowing ServiceMaster has over 50 years of experience. They'll do the job right every time with locations in Auburn and Falmouth. They can be reached at 539-4452. For any disaster, just call ServiceMaster. Hi again, everybody. It's John Williams. I'm here with Spencer Morris of Rolfe Corporation out of Bridgeton, Maine. Your source for all of your landscaping needs, and as we head towards fall and winter, all of the needs that you're going to have for both residents and business. Spencer, great to see you again.
Yeah, nice to see you, John. We're busy as ever over at Rolfe Corporation. We've got loam, gravel, stone, sand, and gravel all in stock and ready to go, whether it's patching up a driveway, getting ready for the plow guy, or just trying to get a little grass growing with some of that poor man's fertilizer that's in the near future.
And speaking of, here comes winter. So talk a little bit about how Rolfe Corporation can help get you prepared for the winter ahead.
Yeah, after we get through fall and we get through our major cleanups where you can always dispose of brush and leaves at Rolfe Corporation for just $5. After we get through all of that, we're going to start looking at snow. And you got icy driveways at your home or business. We've got salt sand. You can either come and pick it up in our yard, or we can deliver it right to your business, whatever works best for you. So if you got any of those needs, give us a call, 207-647-9500. You can visit us at rolfecorp.com, or you can get a hold of us on our Facebook page.
Rolfe Corporation out of Bridgeton, Maine. Give them a call today. And we are back once again in the pits. It is our Friday and weekend show, everybody. We've just finished up a half an hour of talking with our very good friend and frequent guest, Dr. Dick Bergen, joining us and talking about national, international, local, regional racing, and some of the stories that he brings with him as a Hall of Fame broadcaster and a driver as well. So once again, John, joined by Scott, by Dana, and by Mark. Welcome back, guys. What's going on? In addition to what we've been talking about with Dick.
I mean, it's I'm sitting in my car in my driveway. Is that what you're asking?
Oh, yeah. Okay. So yeah. How's that? So yeah. Talk a little bit about that.
No, I'm all set. Yeah, I mean, I guess the biggest news story in motorsports right now is this Brandon Brown situation. And so he came out with an article, or he put an article out, or he paid to have an article written in Newsweek or one of those New York publications that said he, you know, he's finally speaking on the Let's Go Brandon thing, and saying, you know, he doesn't really want to be any part of the politicizing of his name, right? And I think it's fair to say that he's screwed. I mean, there's no other way to put it. He's never going to get tied to be a sponsor of him because of a decision that NBC made. And that's unfortunate, you know, and you could say, well, why wouldn't Tide? Because the minute that Tide announces their sponsorship of Brandon Brown, they're going to get destroyed on social media of, well, clearly you're supporting a guy that is, you know, against President Biden. When Brandon Brown had no association with that at all, he just won a race and they changed the chant from the Biden chant to his name. So he's never going to get any of those sponsors. And that's unfortunate for him because he needs those to continue on. So he announces that he's, you know, got some sponsorship, cryptocurrency sponsorship yesterday that has the initials of Let's Go Brandon in it. And he should be the only one that's making money off of this. He should be the only. There are plenty of people making money off of his name. He should be the only one making money off of it. And people immediately jump to, you know, well, that's this sponsorship clearly is anti the president, which it isn't. But unfortunately, he's in such an area right now where he cannot win with anything that he does. And it's a huge news story right now because it sounds like NASCAR is not going to approve it, even though it sounds like they maybe already did. I don't know. It's going to be an interesting few days.
Yeah, NASCAR was saying that Brandon Brown's team jumped the gun on the announcement. That was their take on it. And then Bob Pockers reported that this new cryptocurrency is basically a digital version of the old Franklin Mint stuff. It's not even a thing like a Bitcoin or anything like that. You know, basically you buy it and it's worthless. So you're buying it as a digital souvenir. So just a weird thing. I can't imagine that they're going to sell a ton of this stuff. And, you know, it's,
I mean, if they got any money to back this up, Dana, I mean, if it's basically worthless,
nobody really knows.
Yeah.
That part of it's all kind of irrelevant at this point. It's going to come down to whether or not it gets approved anyway. And listen, there's so many things, as I've learned over the last 3 years working with Ryan and JTG and Kroger and everything that has to get approved. It doesn't get that far without some approvals. It got that far with some approvals. So to say that it was completely that they jumped the gun, I don't know that that's a fair statement. So
that's what they said.
Sure. Yep. I hear you. Sure. but it is, I mean, you're talking, you know, several week process of getting this stuff approved. So, I don't know. I don't know that I'm fully believing that one.
So another sponsor note, M&M Mars announced they're going to stop their sponsorship of Joe Gibbs Racing and Kyle Busch. They've been in the sport for 30 years, over 30 years. What plays into a company like that pulling their sponsorship from probably one of the most talented race car drivers in the world.
Because they've been in it for 30 years? I mean, that's really what it comes down to. Dave Alpern, who's the head of Joe Gibbs Racing, was on one of the serious shows, and he said that, you know, would they love to have him forever? Sure. But they know that, with, you know, 30 years into a relationship is find many other sponsors that have been in any sport for that long. You get people, shareholders, people, new people that come in as CEOs or CFOs or anything, and they want to try something different. They know what they have with NASCAR, and they know what they've done with it. Now they want to try and do something different and reallocate those funds. So,
Sometimes it comes down to agency. They change agencies and that type of thing. I've seen that happen with my own company. And you know, it's just, it isn't, it, as you just mentioned, it hasn't got anything to do with whether it was successful or not, which is the weird thing about it, is it has to do with just people changing their minds about where they want to push their money. And a lot of people come in with ideas, and they feel like, you know, if they don't make these changes, then they're not relevant. And we see that happen a lot. And oftentimes, in association with these sponsorships that are leaving, they talk about the fact that, you know, we want to look in this direction. We want to look in this direction. We've been very, very happy with NASCAR, but here's another direction we want to go in. So it's always interesting to hear, you know, the discussions and conversations associated with these kinds of changes, because it's big money.
Yeah, the sad part of business nowadays, and it's the sad reality of business nowadays, is that you can't keep doing the same thing. And to witness that, you know, a company that did the same thing and is now basically out of business, you know, just look at Sears. Sears did the exact same thing all these years, and then Amazon came in and did what they did, but found a newer, better way to do it. And Sears just kept doing the same thing, and now they're out of business. And I'm sure M&M Mars is looking at that and saying, you know, we got to change. And that's the bad thing, is you never know when to change. When is the right time? So at some point, you kind of have to flip the coin and go for it, you know, and I'm sure everybody got their money's worth out of this. You know, M&M Mars, they had a great relationship and got a lot of eyeballs on their logos. So I think it was a good situation for everybody. But at some point, you know, the business dictates you have to do something new.
And this is, you know, kind of a misnomer, is that it just happened. Joe Gibbs Racing knew about this almost a year ago, that this contract was going to run out and they weren't going to renew. So they've been, you know, working this entire time to find a replacement that wasn't a primary on that car for every single race. So they need to fill, I thought I saw 23 races in some form or fashion, you know, because M&M Mars has a million brands that they're actually servicing. So I think it was 23 races that they need to fill, and I mean, they're going to have no problem filling those, and especially when you give them a year head start.
And that shows how much M&M Mars valued their relationship, is they gave him that much time notice. If you don't value relationship, you know, the contract is up in 2 weeks, and then you go, or you just start, you stop returning phone calls. I mean, that's really how the companies with no integrity do it. The companies with integrity who value relationship, they have to say, hey, tough decision, but, you know, we have to go in a different direction.
Any companies out there that names have been elevated associated with this? I mean, not necessarily for all 23 races, but are there some names that have been thrown around that are potential sponsors coming up in 2022?
Well, it's not 22, it's 23.
I'm sorry, 23. Anyway. I meant 23.
No, because, you know, they're going to keep that close to the vest, because if they come up and say who they're working with, then Stuart Haas is going to steal them, or Hendrick's going to steal them. I mean, honestly, that's how it works in this business. So, you know, it's just how it is.
It just seems like there's become an evolution over the past 2 years that actual cash sponsorships are dwindling a little bit. M&M Mars leaves. You saw Lowe's leave Hendrick Motorsports with Jimmy Johnson, 7-time cup champion, and Hendrick ends up with a B2B deal. So I don't think the B2B deals, even though they look good on the car and it looks like the car is sold, it doesn't bear a lot of fruit as far as financially goes. So I'd like to see a new company come in with cash and not a B2B deal like we've seen a lot of over the past few years.
Well, wait a minute. B2B has been pretty successful. Let me give you a couple. DuPont 24, that was B2B. There was this GM Goodrich 3 car. Yeah, that was B2B. So probably the two most iconic sponsorships in the history of the sport were really B2B deals, business to business. GM and Goodrich and DuPont, you know, probably two of the most iconic.
But generally,
In the quote heyday of NASCAR, that's what fueled sponsorships was the if you were a primary sponsor on a car, you had access to, you know, the big decision makers of major companies who also had primary sponsorships on their cars. Mm-hmm. And that was the selling point. That's why you saw a lot of those weird I call them weird sponsors because, you know, they're things that I would never buy, you know, so as a consumer, you kind of cross, and DuPont's a perfect example, you know, but that was because, you know, now the executive DuPont are rubbing elbows with the executives of the, you know, the major manufacturing companies selling their paint. So, and their chemicals. So yeah, that NASCAR, that was when they hit their heydays when they're doing B2B.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We're going to take another break. And when we come back, just kind of a review of our year and talking a little bit with all of my co-hosts about what we can look forward to in 2022. I do want to mention before we go to our actual commercial break, I want to talk about a couple of sponsors that are still with us and are going to continue to be significantly important as we move into 2022. One of them is Grants Kennebago Camps up on beautiful Kennebago Lake in the Rangeley Lakes region. And, you know, this is not fly fishing season, but I can tell you that if you're looking to rent or reserve space at Grants Camps starting in May, when the ice is gone, you'll want to start doing that now. Just go to grantscamps.com and you can get all the information about renting one of their beautiful cottages up there and some of the finest fly fishing for salmon, brook trout, and brown trout in the entire United States. And then, of course, Northern Outdoors. They officially opened for snowmobiling this past Wednesday. And the 29th of December, they will be open, consistently right through the rest of the winter, right through the end of March, and maybe into the 1st of April, depending on how the winter goes with snowmobiling. We still need more snow, no question about that. Certainly, Russell made that clear the other day when he was on the show. But the fact is that Northern Outdoors is now open. Go to northernoutdoors.com for all the information about snowmobiling. They have rentals. You can have up there brand new snowmobiles with one of the affiliations they have up there with one of the sports centers. And on top of that, just some beautiful accommodations. NorthernOutdoors.com, really kind of your headquarters for snowmobiling in 2022. And right now we'll take a little bit of break and we'll be right back. Hold on.
We're talking with our friend Joe Galetta from Ripley and Fletcher Ford in South Paris. Joe, why do so many people choose Ripley and Fletcher Ford?
I really think that it just comes down to people want to do business with people that they trust. And for the last 8 years at Ripley and Fletcher Ford, I've made it my goal to surround my customers with people that they want to do business with. My people at Ripley and Fletcher Ford are the best people you're going to find anywhere, anywhere. You know, from that first contact, they really feel it. They sense it. They can tell that this is a place that they want to do business. And you know, every dealer says it's going to be the best deal, it's going to be the best price, and it's no different at Ripley and Fletcher Ford. You're going to get a great deal here. It's really the experience that sets us apart. And you know, the bottom line, like anything, customers, when they feel appreciated and they feel they've been treated fairly and they feel they've gotten their money's worth, and they know as they're leaving where they're coming the next time they need to do business.
Ripley and Fletcher Ford, Main Street in South Paris, and online at ripleyandfletcherford.com.
Hi, Steve Roop here from Rooper's Beverage and Redemption, a locally owned and operated business in Lewiston since 1992, also located in Auburn and Oxford. And I think you all know what we do, but we are the ultimate package store in Central Maine. If you need a special order or something for a party, weddings, anniversaries, call us. We'll get that package ready for you. All you have to do is drive up and remember, the party starts with Rupert's. Drink responsibly. Don't drink and drive, folks.
And welcome back once again, everybody. In the pits. It is our Friday and our weekend show. You're listening to us now. You're listening live. Or you can listen right through the weekend, right through the New Year's Day and into 2022, Saturday and Sunday, on the Big Jab down in Portland and OXO, up here in the western foothills of Maine and across central Maine as well. We'll be on both Saturday and Sunday. I also wanted to mention we've got a couple of great new sponsors that will be joining us as of going on the air Monday evening for our first show of 2022, and that is Norway Savings Bank, a longtime sponsor with the Williams Broadcasting Group, but a first-time sponsor with In the Pits, and I couldn't be more excited about that. It's always wonderful when you have a sponsor that has been involved with your company on a number of different levels for many years, and then they realize that this particular program, In the Pits, is providing a great opportunity to get their message out to a whole new audience, and they're looking forward to being on the air with us beginning on Monday as well. And also Oxford Plains Speedway. We've been talking a lot about that. We had a chance to talk with Mike Mayberry a couple of weeks ago before Christmas. And they're very excited about being involved with the show and working with the show and helping promote the show as much as we promote the Speedway. So we're looking forward to both of them being with us and kicking things off for 2022. So excited about that, guys. No question about it. It's great. And I guess I could start the rest of the show by simply saying, you know, as we head toward the end of 2021 and we head into our 20th consecutive year of broadcasting, and it was highlighted by Dick Bergeron saying there are not many shows that can claim that they've been able to broadcast as consistently as we have over the last 19 years. But heading into our 20th year of broadcasting, can't do these things without great hosts, and the three of you are terrific, and we look forward to another great year with you. I also want to take a moment, we'll talk more about that next week, and hopefully in the next couple of weeks we can get both of these gentlemen on the air with us. I'd like to get Bill Ryan to join us, perhaps even in studio, and also try to get Travis Barrett involved as well. Of course, Bill Ryan and Travis Barrett were my first two co-hosts. And then Scott took over, and then Dana. Dana has been sort of there right along. And then, of course, Mark LaBelle joining us, over 3 years ago now, I believe, Mark. And so this is what makes a show like this as good as it is and able to attract the kind of audience that we have, and also the great interviews that we bring to the show, like our interview with Dick Bergeron today. One of the real class acts of motorsports racing, no question about that. I also want to make a program note and let everybody know that next Friday on our Friday show and weekend show, we will be joined once again by Mario Andretti, who has become a regular guest on this show over the last 4 or 5 years, and he'll be joining us to talk about the upcoming season and what he's been up to this past fall as well. So everything's good.
Can't wait to talk to Mario.
Yeah. Yeah, it should be fun, and I don't know whether he'll have any kind of I don't know after a couple, 2-3 weeks whether he'll have any kind of a different take on the end of the Formula One season, but I suspect he'll probably have some comment to make about it, along with lots of other things as well. We do look forward, by the way, everybody out there, to once again, as we head into our 20th season, we will be bringing some special guests aboard in addition to the Bill Ryans and the Travis Barretts of the world. We're going to probably be talking with some of the folks down at WJAB, John Van Hogenstein, Shu and Joe, who were kind of an integral part of this show when we were broadcasting from the studio
studios of WJAB for a number of years before we went to our own studios here in Norway, Maine. And so we'll be getting them on the air. We'll get Stan Bennett to join us, and he can talk a little bit about what he's been doing with our show when it comes to syndicating it on WOXO and some of the gains that he has made in broadcasting here, not only in the western part of the state, but all across the central part of the state as well. So lots of exciting stuff coming up. And, yeah, I mean, it's just looking forward to a great season ahead. And it seems, guys, as though, you know, we head into January and then suddenly, bang, here comes the race season again.
Jeez, it's...
Well, John, I'll tell you, the unsung hero of these past 19 years is Wendy Williams. She really pulls all the strings on this program. So kudos to Wendy for putting up with us and everybody else for all these years.
Yeah, she's good. She's the best. And she works behind the scenes. I don't think... I ever can remember any time in which she has sat in front of a microphone on the show, although there have been many times that I've encouraged her to do so because she's a great advocate for her gender. And but she's always saying things to me like, I can't do that. I can't do that. Well, I know she can, but she just chooses not to. But behind the scenes, she's the one that works out the business affairs of this company and of this show. And she certainly has been an extraordinary advocate for not only for In the Pits, but also all of the other shows that we produce with the Williams Broadcasting Group. Yeah. Thank you, Mark, for that. I appreciate that. Really do. And the other thing is that my hope in 2022, even though we're still kind of stuck in the middle of yet another COVID-19 surge, I didn't mean to bring that into the conversation today, but I will, only from the perspective that I'd like to get you guys back in the studio. When you're feeling comfortable to do that. It's always more fun to have you sitting across from me. It's always more fun to have you in the chairs. It also actually is good from the perspective of the technology of what we do. Skype has made some great changes. They've needed to. And subsequently, our audio has improved even more since that has happened. But the fact is that I'd love to have you guys in studio. So we'll look forward to that.
Yeah. I mean, I'd love to be there. I would have been there. I was planning on being there Monday, but you canceled.
We did cancel it on Monday. Yeah, we did. I needed a week off. I needed a week off. And it really isn't a week off because we produce two shows a week. So once again, for those people who say, well, you didn't broadcast 52 weeks in a row, and that's not true. We did. We just took one of our days off. But, yeah, we'll be on the air right through the weekend as well. And, yeah, we'd love to have you back in the studio. And, Mark, we'd love to get you up here again as soon as you can. Love to get you up here to the state of Maine and in studio as well. Yeah. And then get you over to the casino so you can lose some money. You know?
I always leave money in Maine when I go up there.
You have to make that new senior director of marketing look good.
Yes, and by the way, thank you very much for bringing that up. Congratulations, Dana, on your new position with the casino. And I'd also like to make mention of another gentleman that I certainly have dealt a lot with over the years and kind of in the background when it comes to marketing and advertising, but someone who has been very, very involved along with Dana, and that is Matt Gallagher, who has been elevated to the position of general manager at the casino. And I got to tell you, Dana, that's a good move and on the part of Churchill Downs, and it's going to be tremendously successful, I think, for the casino in Oxford. And once again, congratulations to both of you. Terrific picks by Churchill Downs.
Thank you.
You are most welcome. It's good stuff, guys. It's all good stuff. Any final comments, guys, before we say goodbye? We've got just a little under 2 minutes to go, and we got to get out of here.
I just want to know how much Dana makes now.
I make half of what you make.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh, yeah, absolutely. Well, it's in good hands.
In other words, about half a million a year, right?
There you go. Yeah,
yeah, right. Yeah, that's roughly
yeah,
around.
Yeah, there you go. Okay. Jeez. I need to wait a minute.
I want to see Dana's new house.
Yeah,
that's all my Oxford 250 bonus for the year.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. That big win. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. That's got to be the highlight of your year, right, Scott?
I got a couple. Probably my most successful year professionally ever. So yeah. I'll take it.
Yeah, American Canadian tour director now. It just, you know, it just keeps coming, man, which is great. And Mark, you got a brand new career, which you are engaged in and embracing, which I think is wonderful. No question about it, man. It's great.
You still love it.
Yeah.
Best thing I ever did.
Absolutely.
2021 was big for a lot of people, I think.
I think you're right about that. A lot of changes taking place, but some of them very, very positive. So we'll go out on that positive note. And once again, Scott, thank you. Dana, thank you. Mark, thank you. Happiest of New Year's to you and your families. And we'll see you again Monday at 6 o'clock. Take care,
you
guys.
Too.
Bye-bye.